Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of 2024 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Our first item of business is the fourth evidence session of the Committee's inquiry into the disability employment gap in Scotland. This morning we will focus on the support available to help young disabled people transition from the education system into employment in adulthood. May I welcome Tracy Francis, Policy and Development Worker for the Scottish Transitions Forum Association of Real Change Scotland, Anne-Marie Sturrock, Vice-Principal, Student Experience Colleges Scotland, and Dr Charlotte Pearson, Senior Lecturer in Social and Public Policy, University of Glasgow. Thank you everybody. And if members and witnesses could keep their answers as concise and precise as possible, that would be helpful. If I'd maybe start with a question, the committee has undertaken this piece of work because the government have a target to halve the disability employment gap by 2038. And we're undertaking this piece of work to see if we're on target to achieve that. And we're interested in what are the key kind of remaining challenges to closing the employment gap in Scotland. You will have a chance to expand broader on a lot of the issues I might ask you to address briefly at the start, but I'll come first to Tracy, if you want to maybe talk about what some of the remaining challenges are to closing the disability employment gap.
Well, I think for young people, and I should say that the young people that we work to support, it's between the ages of 14 to 25. So it's the people who are going from children's services to adult services. It's the people who are... All of those changes are taking place, and I can talk a lot more about that a little bit later. But I think it's just such a complex transition going from, you know, sort of being in school, then into the world of adulthood, the world of work, trying to work out what you want to do and who you want to be. And the support that is there for young people at the moment, I would say, is pretty inadequate. I think a lot of young people are having a very, very difficult task to get the support that they need to think through what life might be like and how they might be able to make that work for them. And when you have people who have additional support needs, I mean, the clue is in the name. They need extra support to be able to make that transition. They're not going to make it without that support. And if that's not there, and if that's not doing the right task, I think that they're actually on a bit of a track that's taking them down the wrong direction. So, you know, it's looking at it holistically. And I think at the moment, we're not set up to do that. The support structures are not in place. The planning is not in place. And I think, you know, the help to guide young people into a positive outcome for them is not there. I would say that's probably the biggest single challenge that they might face.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to come to Anne-Marie next. So a similar question for you, Anne-Marie. In terms of being able to close the employment gap, what are the remaining kind of key challenges? What are the barriers that would make it difficult for us to do that?
So I think it varies depending on the individual. It's a very complex landscape out there. In a previous life, I used to be a job finder and a job coach for people with learning disabilities. And in my experience, it's about having a good support network. It is about having the services out there to support an individual into employment. Transitions is key. You know, across Scotland, there's different transition arrangements into employment, transition arrangements into colleges, transition arrangements out of colleges and into employment, and getting the support services for people to get into employment. It's very individual. Needs based. You know, I have supported people in employment where with some people it took 2 weeks to train an individual into their role, and other people it could take me 6 months depending on the complexities of the job. It takes time. You know, there are the key principles of supported employment for people with learning disabilities and for people with autism, and there's almost 5 steps associated to that, and we had a discussion in the corridor just before we came in, and one of the most important aspects is spending the time with the young person, with their family, doing what's called a vocational profile, understanding their needs. Sometimes you could miss something, you could get the right job for the right person at the right time, and then you find out, oh, this individual is not an independent traveller, so we've missed something in the support. In my experience, it's a multi-agency approach to supported employment for people with learning disabilities and people who have autism. It's not one department or one agency that can do it. Also, if you get the the golden apple as such, and you actually secure employment for somebody, it's the long-time support thereafter. Previously, funding was a year-on thing, you know, so you had a great support network in getting people employment, but if the funding stopped, the support stopped. So it's a long-term support, and it's the social model of disability that you try to empower through the process of supported employment for people with learning disabilities, rather than the medical model of disability. It's complex. It's very individualised. The needs of the young person, the wishes of the young person have to be taken into consideration. To me, the most important step, and this is based on experience, is the completion of the vocational profile with the parents, with the young person, or with a service who supports the young person if they might be in residential care, to get all the needs assessed prior to going into employment, and thereafter going seeking out, looking for employers to match the wishes of the young person, supporting the young person in the role and being there for the employer and the individual once they have become independent in the role. So it's not a short-term fix, it's a long-term solution that we need to address the employment gap for people with learning disabilities and autism in Scotland.
And do you think the majority of people who need that support at the moment are accessing that support or have that support?
No,
I don't think so. No.
Charlotte, I know you've not had a chance to answer yet. But one of the through ARC and through the Scottish Transitions Forum, we have over 1,000 members that include professionals, young people, and parents and carers. And I run the Parent and Carer Network for the Scottish Transitions Forum. And you know, the evidence, the anecdotal evidence that's coming through, you know, is just it's not happening. No, they do not have the support. It's a real challenge. And I should just say, you know, for me, this has a personal dimension as well. I have a young, a daughter who is a young woman now who's in her 20s. She's autistic. And we are struggling at the moment with precisely this, trying to find a workplace for her. And it is proving incredibly difficult. And I work in the field and, you know, I kind of know what I'm doing around this. And it's proving incredibly difficult to crack. So I can well believe that lots of families across the country, you know, will be really, really struggling.
Yeah. I'll come to Charlotte now. Morning. Charlotte, it'd be interesting to hear your reflections on the progress being made towards 2038 and what you think the key challenges are in achieving halving the disability employment gap.
Yeah, I suppose not to repeat the points made about the structural barriers from Anne-Marie and Tracy. The point I would add is kind of around attitudinal barriers for young people. Both Anne-Marie and Tracy emphasised the importance of early intervention, and I think that's critical to have conversations around employment expectations, aspiration, but to have them really early in the school process. From the young people we've spoken to in our research, it's very clear that's not happening, and there isn't a huge amount of support from within school systems. There's an expectation that many of the young people we've spoken to aren't going to be in employment. That's not for them. The message is kind of like, that's not going to be your life course. And yet, then you leave school, and governments are quite rightly concerned about the employment gap and the pushes to say, well, actually, you need to think about employment. But this conversation hasn't been had, you know, until perhaps 15, 16 at the earliest. Whereas if you're starting to integrate, as Anne-Marie said, vocational profiling, careers discussion, if that's done earlier, that kind of support starts to get that conversation and dialogue happening at much earlier stage.
Mm-hmm. And in terms of government, it is a government target to halve the gap. Yeah. In terms of government policy or drivers or levers, is there, you know, do you think there's enough happening, or is it clear what it is the government are doing in order to try and make that, reduce that gap?
I think it's clear. I think there is a real problem with key services, key areas of policies not joined up. So there is, you know, when when children are leaving school, even the age range of defined adulthood in different areas of policies can be very arbitrary. It can be changed. That can be incredibly confusing. You might have health and social care services provided to one age cohort, and yet in others that's much less. That's incredibly difficult. Policy needs to stop working in silos and kind of think about how it can join up and achieve those targets. I mean, in terms of employment, there are, policies like access to work. When they work well, they're great. It's a really innovative policy. But, the narrative, the research suggests that there's delays in getting it. Young people, particularly young disabled people, may not have that information. It may be unaware of, access to work, provisions of reasonable adjustments in the equalities legislation. There's a whole range. I think in many ways policy is there, whether it's enforced and whether attitudes have conducive to making that work. It's not a blank canvas by any means. There is a network of transition support there. It's just whether it's working effectively is the question.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Colin Smith to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Can I just follow up on that point, Charlotte? So I'm trying to work out why. I mean, first of all, why is that support so important for those young people? But you said there's a network of support already there. It's just not functioning correct. So is the support there, and it's the way it works, or is the support not there? I'm just trying to work out what the gap is, and why is that support so important for those young people?
The support is on paper there. Whether individual young people are accessing it is a question, which I would probably say they're not accessing it, certainly the people we've spoken to, and not consistently. And it goes back to about sort of early intervention. The ideal approach would be, as Anne-Marie says, have vocational profiling, get that started in school, have those conversations, have that network of support. If you, for example, you've got support around, education support, but you haven't got your social care package, there's that gap. Some of the parents we've spoken to haven't even heard of self-directed support, the kind of functions of social care in Scotland. So there seems to be a real problem with getting not only the support out there, but getting information as well.
And Amory, you mentioned that as well, that there's it's not joined up effectively. How do we join it up then? How do we make sure? You talked about the... It needs to be personalised to the individual. So how do you change policy that we're not working in silos, that you're actually bringing people together to make sure that it is personalised? What's missing at the moment to make it personalised?
So I think policy is one thing. The services there to back up the implementation of the policies is another. And, in Scotland, let's say Colleges Scotland, we run a project search, so do some universities, for people with learning disabilities and for people with autism. This project is a year long, but it is about getting people employment at the end of it. But it's for a finite amount of people get onto this course, because we can take 10 a year in each. So the services are disjointed. There's not enough services for people with learning disabilities for supported employment. And I do think, SDS, our Department of Work and Pensions, do quite well. But when you have a policy, we need to ensure that we have the services there for young people to be able to meet the outcomes of the policy. The services to back up these policies are so important.
Tracy, why do it make such a difference?
Yeah, I think one of the big challenges that we could maybe try and start doing something to address is the fact that when young people are moving into adulthood, as I said before, they're moving from children's services into adult services. And a lot of policy groups, for example, policy advisory groups, focus on children or they focus on adults. There are very few that actually come together and look at that bit where the two join up or don't join up. And I think that's, one of the things that could be done is maybe to try and bring some of those policy advisory groups together a little bit more. Doesn't have to be all the time, but, even if it was just every now and then, to come together to recognise that it's a person's life and it's not, we're not in categories. We need something that's smooth, that's going to smooth that transition. I think that's one thing that could be done. And we know that... you know, for a lot of, in a lot of local authority areas, the criteria for support within adult services is very different from the criteria in children's services. So again, you know, there's a disconnect. There's something almost like baked into the system that means that they're not going to match that easily. And if we were able to do something around that, and I think one of the things that we've found through work that we've done in the Scottish Transitions Forum, we did a pilot project a couple of years ago called Principles into Practice, which was around, you know, sort of putting what makes a good transition into implementing that in local authority settings. We worked with 10 local authorities around this. And what one local authority did was employ, for that 2 years, a transitions coordinator. It was somebody who bridged that gap. And she worked right the way through with followed families, you know, through from that sort of 14, 15 up to into early 20s. And they have now decided on the back of that, that they're going to employ more people in that role or to support her role, because that's something that has made a real difference. Now, that's not around employment specifically, it's around transition experiences. But as we were saying, if the transition experience is smooth, then it's a lot easier then to have conversations about employment, because people have got the bread and butter in place, if you like. They've got the essentials there.
So, I mean, so that's a really interesting point, because we had a group of young people up from the usual place in Dumfries, and mm-hmm. one of the points that, that one of the staff were making was that often they slip through the gaps in funding because they're not education, they're not employment, they're kind of, they bridge the two, they go between the two, but they don't, every time they apply for funding, sorry, that's education, that's employment. I mean, is it, so I'm just trying to work out the barrier to that. It's a bit of silo working, but is it because actually we don't actually put in place an actual I suppose that bridge, if you like. We're not funding the bridge, we're funding the two things separately. Is that probably a fair reflection?
I think that's a really good point. Yes, I think you know, building bridges between those areas so that it's not like I have seen a visual image of this where it's a series of cliff edges, and you can fall over the cliff edge, and I'm sure you've probably heard that term before. But if there's a bridge between those two cliffs so that you can walk across that, you're less likely to fall down through the cracks. If we could focus on where the bridges are and how we can support those and build those, I think that would make a big difference.
Okay. Just before I bring in Colin Beattie, Tracy, because you mentioned a personal experience, and looking at figures we saw last week, people with autism have the lowest employment rate out of any health conditions for 16 to 64-year-olds. And autistic graduates are twice as likely to be unemployed after 15 months as non-disabled graduates, with only 36% finding full-time work in this period. So I don't know if you want to say a bit more about, when we're talking about transitions, it's not always the school leavers. Sometimes we're talking about people who are very qualified and who are graduates, but they're finding difficulty because of their condition and finding employment. And if there's any support for kind of young people who are that age or with those skills?
I think, again, there is support there on paper. There's Skills Development Scotland. You know, there are other agencies, Enable Works. You know, there are other agencies that are working with these young people. A lot of the time, the communication is not there. So young people aren't hearing who can help. And crucially, it feels to me that families are not hearing who can help either. We did a piece of work, again, it's a few years ago now, called Facing the Future Together. And that was interviewing families and young people about what their expectations were for transitions. And 85%, 86% of young people said that they expected to get information about the future from their parents. They weren't looking to schools necessarily, that was like the icing on the cake, but they were expecting to get that from their parents. And the parents were telling us, we don't know, we can't find this information, it's not being targeted towards us. So I think when you have somebody who is not within the school system, and actually this could apply equally to people who are out of school for a whole raft of reasons. They could be home educated, they could be people who have a health condition that means they can't attend. They're not plugged into that school network. So how do they find out about what could help them, where they can go? Mm-hmm. And even though someone for example might be very highly educated, they could be very well qualified, they could have a PhD, you know, there are plenty of autistic people out there who are have very high levels of academic qualifications, but navigating the social landscape is one of the things that autistic people find really, really challenging. So if you've got this labyrinthine system that they have to try and work their way through, they're going to be overwhelmed and they're going to find that really challenging. So I think making the information, you know, really, really clear, really direct and targeted to the young people and also to the parents and carers would be, you know, really, really helpful.
Mm. And what about employers? Where do they fit in on this? And we're talking about graduates, and do you think there needs to be more? We've had some discussion in the committee around this inquiry around how people apply for jobs and the recruitment process, mm-hmm. and I mean, do you think there needs to be changes there? What about the role of employers?
Yeah. I think it feels to me like you know, a lot of employers would like to make a change. They would like to have a more diverse workforce around disability. There are challenges for them. I think there are employers who are a little bit afraid about that because they don't know what to do. They don't want to get it wrong. They want to be able to support somebody, mm-hmm. but they're not quite sure how to do it. There's obviously the implications of how much time it might take to support somebody. And I think this is where, you know, Anne-Marie, you were saying about job coaches and that continuity and people continuing with support into the early sort of 6 months, a year of work, so that some of that pressure is taken off the employers. I think that would be something that would be really beneficial.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Colin Beattie to be followed by Maggie Chatwin.
Thank you, Vina. We had the benefit of having some young people who had been through the experience of getting support and so on. They came here and we had the opportunity to speak to them and get their views, which is really valuable. The ones I spoke to were very scathing about what they received at school in the way of support. And subsequent to that, as they transitioned on, they were fairly scathing about the job centres as well. They felt the job centres didn't know what to do with them. Now, I also had the opportunity in the last week to visit a couple of schools in my constituency, and I've got one high school which has 49.5% additional support needs, and I've got a primary school with 54% additional support needs. I mean, that sort of scale is huge. How do we address that, Anne-Marie?
So I think colleges play a huge part in that also in terms of the transition. It's getting in there very early, working with a young person, working with their family, looking at what their needs are. 49% is, did you say 49%?
9.5.
And is that primary or secondary?
In the primary, that's secondary.
Right.
Primary, 54%. And these are not unusual percentages in my area, and I know my area is slightly higher than some.
So I live in your area, and I have a daughter in probably one of the schools that you mentioned who probably falls under that 49% because of a medical issue. And I will shout this until somebody listens to me. It has to be done on an individual basis. Percentages are one thing, the people behind that percentage is another. It's about getting in at a very early stage, spending time as a multidisciplined agency. Colleges play a part in that, the schools play a part in that. Skills Development Scotland for sure have careers officers within the schools and assigning more time to work with these people, including my daughter, who you have met, by the way, to look at what is it they want to do? What are the steps that we need to help to get there? And I keep saying on my notes, this is not one agency's responsibility. This is a collective responsibility to get the best outcome for we're talking about children and young people here, but I've worked quite a lot with adults too, transitioning, let's say they've got their tenancy and then they go from their tenancy into employment and they have a purpose in life, you know, it's different. It's about working together as a multi-agency group, the colleges, the SES, DYW, the schools, learning support team, in getting the transitions. We keep going back to the right transitions, transitions out of school, maybe transitions into college, transition into employment. But if there's an issue in employment, how to support the employer, how to support the young person, it's a multi-agency approach. To address that.
I don't disagree with anything you say. I mean, everything's individual, and each person responds in different ways, and you have to build the support around that. My concern is the scale.
Yeah.
I mean, it's worrying at that level. And how do the resources get put in place for this? I mean, it's not just a question of money, it's people and the support that people can give to these young people. How do we do it? That's an impossible question.
So the scale is not something that concerns me, because I think every person, irrespective if you have a disability or not, a learning disability or not, a medical, should have a good transition out of school, should have a good transition into college, and should have a good transition into work. And in the long term, that will save money. If we do it right when children are young, you know, we save it in the end. So there is an investment required. Sitting down and having dialogue with a young person, looking at, just listening to the young person, what do they want, listening to parents. I know we've had a discussion about that. Parents are a key part in this, or if a young person is in residential care, getting the whole profile and getting it right at a very young age. It is costly, but it's worth it. So I can't answer your question, because I don't have, a magic wand.
No.
But I do think early intervention is better than trying to go around and pick up people who have fallen through the system. One good thing that works is the agreement. It's called the FEPA, the Further Education Partnership Agreement, that we have with SDS. And we know coming through, that the colleges have with SDS, excuse me, we know coming through the amount of young people who may not have a positive destination. We know the amount of young people coming through who that might have a learning disability and may have to go into supported ed. So we can work our curriculum around that in advance. And colleges work quite well. We work shoulder to shoulder. It's an Irish woman saying that. But with Skills Development Scotland, with the schools, to make sure the transition is the right thing for the right individual.
Charlotte, can I maybe ask you to comment?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it touches on the additional support for learning inquiry, which reported last week about the position of additional support needs in mainstream schools. And, you know, the argument there is around, is mainstreaming the right approach for this? And I think most people would argue that, you know, there's no reason why disabled children shouldn't be in mainstream schools, but I'm afraid it does come back to having to have, you have to have the support there. And I mean, the numbers you've in your constituency, they are high. And there isn't an answer without putting the support in place to put the resource and the understanding. And I think it comes back again to issues around attitudes. Have some understanding, have some training, have some conversations around disability in schools for teachers, for other children, make that environment more supportive for learning. There, as Anne-Marie says, there isn't an easy answer. A lot of it is resource driven, but also it's a culture change as well within schools, within mainstream schools.
At the sort of percentages I talked about, do the resources actually exist to be able to provide that level of support? Now, I know additional support needs are a whole rainbow of different needs, some of them very light touch and some of them very intensive, but nevertheless all of them need resources. At those sort of percentages, how do we allocate the resources? Where do they come from? And as I say, it's not just money, it's about people that are available to be able to give that support.
I think it comes, I do keep talking about attitudes as well as resources. The easiest thing is for me to say, well, it is about resources. You need to put extra support teachers in, extra specialised disability advisors in schools. However, I do think you've also got to work with the school populations you've got there as well. You've got to, you know, we've spoken to young people who've asked for reasonable adjustments to be made around exams because they find the exam environment difficult. And there was one student who couldn't physically deal with the demands of the school uniform, and she was told, no, that couldn't be done. that, you know, that kind of change can be made very easily, but that to me comes from a position of someone not having an understanding of diverse needs of issues around disability. So I think, as Anne-Marie says, it is a resource issue, but also it is a cultural issue in schools as well.
I think I would completely agree with that. I mean, I would be. We know. I think teachers do an incredibly difficult job. I think we ask an awful lot of them, as with social workers and so on, that they're overwhelmed. But I think we do fall into the trap sometimes of thinking we've got to put a service in place to be able to meet a need. And I think we don't always have to do that. Exactly as you say, there's things around relatively simple adjustments that could be made if we approach the topic in a slightly different way. And I think, you know, one of the key things is listening to young people and listening to families about what they are saying they need. Because with that figure, as you quoted, sort of nearly 50% or whatever that was, within that 50%, there's going to be a huge range of need. And some people probably only need a light touch. They might need something like, you say, an adjustment to school uniform, being able to wear noise-cancelling headphones. That will actually help. There'll be other people who need a lot more intensive support. So it's around helping, if you can actually respond to what people are saying, this is what will help me, this is what I need, this information, I need this adjustment. And if you can respond to that, then maybe you can free up a little bit of time and energy and resource to help the people who need more intensive support.
Thank you.
I was going to ask... So the government have committed to a national transitions to adulthood strategy by 2026. If you are involved in discussions around that, or how important you see that being, or I think Tracy, is your organisation involved quite heavily?
Yes, we're actively involved in that. We're on the discussion, the executive group around that. And I'm in the process at the moment of running a series of consultations among parents about the national transitions strategy and how that's going to work.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Maggie Chapman to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Kane. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. In some ways, following on from your conversation with Colin, and you've spoken in different ways about the need to change culture. We've heard in previous sessions about people being afraid, not knowing what it will mean to have a disabled young person either in their employment or in their education setting and how to support them. And I suppose one of the ways of overcoming that fear and not completely tackling but addressing some of the culture change issues is to show good examples. And I was wondering, could you talk through some clear examples of when it all works? What does good look like? How you've talked about the vocational profiling, you've talked about multi-agency approaches. When it works, what does that mean? What does it mean for the people providing the support, for the families, for the young people themselves, all of that? Anne-Marie, if you want to start, and then I'll work.
I could give it to you from a college perspective, if that's okay.
Yep,
so in a previous life, I used to teach young people with learning disabilities, and what an example of good is when you align your service to the service, the education service and the social work service. And a good transition is when the social work department employ a transition officer and the college has a transition officer. And an example of good is going in at S2 and meeting the parents, the young person, the teachers involved, and looking at I don't like this word, but I'll say the holistic needs of the young person, their educational needs, their sport needs, their pastoral needs, even things like transport to and from college. Is a work placement the best option when they come into college? So the transition into college is smooth, it's over a few years, and then when they're in college, the programme that's offered in college is all about the transition out of college into employment or into some kind of a service that meets their needs.
Out of college with the same kind of thing. Somebody from college, from the employment or wherever they're going on to. Okay.
The transition in is critical. I would say the transition out of college is even more critical, which is not good English, I know. But we want to give a very smooth process, and I have experience of doing that and working in a college where working with the schools, working with the teachers, working with the transition officer employed by the social work department, aligning our curriculum in the college to match the individual coming through and then the transition out into something that's age appropriate. Mm-hmm. I do believe people with learning disabilities have to have a transition that's age appropriate, but also has an opportunity. So there's an employment service there, but there's also a social work service there that picks up the young person for things like support needs or maybe tenancies. And that is a multi-agency approach to not, I know we're talking about employment here, but there's so much more involved here. It's not just about employment, you know, because you could get somebody with a learning disability 15 hours employment a week, which is a great outcome, but we also need housing, we also need social aspects, we also need spiritual, you know, depending on the young person. So I have experienced that. Mm-hmm. It's not Scotland-wide.
Not common, okay.
When it's there, it works. But I know I'm boring the panel, but this is about every agency aligning itself to key government policies and having the services there.
And having the resources to deliver those services.
Sorry, I said services, but the resources.
That all comes as a package. No, that's fine. Well, just one thing, when you said in that transition, you know, speaking probably from school to colleges, speaking with the colleges and aligning the curriculum,
yes,
that might strike terror into some college lecturers, and I just wonder, can you say a little bit more about what you mean when you say aligning the curriculum? What would that mean for people who have to, you know, you're not talking about redesigning entire programs and that kind of thing.
No, it's often a curriculum. So, in my experience, the curriculum would be confidence building. Mm-hmm. You know, it's making people believe, of course, you can get a job at the end of this. Mm-hmm. Skills, updating skills such as work skills, employment ready, how to build a CV, life skills. I used to teach cooking and I'm not the world's best cook, but life skills, you know, preparing people for what's going to come next.
Yeah.
Residential skills, learning how to form friendships. And this is a curriculum, and people with learning disabilities mm-hmm. and people with autism are entitled to that. It doesn't necessarily have to be a PhD. It is the curriculum to match the needs. Them. And what we need to do with any type of curriculum is allow the young person to practice the skill on a regular occurrence so they can retain the skill. Mm-hmm. And work placement is a huge part of the curriculum and liaison with employers. Okay. So that, we don't do a curriculum for every single person, but it's a broad-based curriculum that meets the needs of the young person.
That's really helpful. Thank you. Charlotte, do you want to come in on that?
Yeah, in our research, we have one young person who is what we would call the success story of transitions. Everything seems to have gone right eventually, although I'm sure there are areas that are difficult. So for him, he has an excellent social worker. His parents are really involved. Interviewed them as well as part of the study, and they did a course called Partners in Policy Making, which In Control ran, which seems to be a very niche course which allows parents to engage and become the advocate and take on that role for the children. His schooling ultimately was a positive experience, and he had a work placement which is now translated into a permanent job. His parents have said that the job is only over the weekend, they'd like him to have more hours. He's also he lives on his own in a supported accommodation as well. So everything is in place, but he's absolutely the exception in our research, but he's the one we talk about. There are other examples of good practice with perhaps smaller packages. So for example, one young person was given a package of support from Glasgow Association for Mental Health, where they spent 3 or 4 hours a week practicing the buses, sorting out the bus network in Glasgow, and that person can now access transport and get to work. And that relatively small package has made a huge impact. So, you know, there's the kind of bigger scale, everything fell in place, but also there are the small examples of of really useful packages that can absolutely change things.
That second example that you give, there's something about making sure that the support is is there consistently, because say
they
bus timing tables changed or something,
exactly.
They might need to go through that process again, but it's not. It shouldn't be a defeating
absolutely
moment.
But the hours were put in over a year period, 3 or 4 hours over a year, and that, you know, that is, that's a success story in, in that sense.
Thank you. And coming to you now, Tracy, what are your views on what good looks like?
I've written down a few things, but just before I come on to that, I just wanted to share an example of, you know, I was saying that resources, obviously they're under pressure. Yeah. I do think sometimes parents and carers are a massive resource that we don't tap into as much as we should, and are not listened to as much as they should. And I'm just thinking about one example of a parent who I know, whose son is now, you know, working full time. He has a full time job, but before he started that job, the parent offered to go into his workplace and talk to the team that he would be working with about the condition that affects him, how it impacts on him, you know, what they could do to help, what to look out for, and how best to support him. And that was very well received, and I think that session went extremely well, and that was crucial, you know, to being able to smooth those first kind of couple of months of being in that placement and give people confidence that not only did they know how to cope with this young man, but also that they had the connection then with the father, so that if something, you know, were to arise within work that they weren't sure, they could come and ask the question. And, you know, that's something that took no resource from anyone else whatsoever. That was something that the parent was able to do. I do appreciate not every parent is in that situation, but that's something that we could do. I think what a good transition looks like, I mean, I've written down first the features, really, and this is with employability in mind. You know, so informed choice, I think, actually the young person and the parents and carers being able to make an informed choice, not just this is a job, it's there, it has
go
money, you know, go for it. I think, you know, that's not going to be sustainable. I mean, you know, who among us would want to do that? We want to do a job that we enjoy doing. So being able to make, having the information there. And then around the informed choice, there may be an element of skills development. So it may require some time for the young person to develop the skills they need to be able to move into that role. And that will be different for everybody. It could be academic qualifications, it could be social skills, it could be a whole range of things. But building in that skills development, that's going to mean when they get there, then they can sustain that much more, much more readily. I think the time element and taking it at the young person's pace, and I think this is one of the things that's so difficult in schools, because people are under such pressure to do things within a time frame that maybe doesn't work for them for a whole host of reasons. And if we can have a little bit more flexibility somehow around that, and let the young person take the time they need until they feel the confidence and feel that they're able to go it alone, whatever that looks like for them. And then making it sustainable, we've talked about transport, you know, the things that need to be in place for that job to work out. And then, you know, once that has gone smoothly, the person's in a place they've chosen or had some degree of choice around, they're feeling comfortable that they've got the skills to be able to do it, then, you know, what comes next? I think we tend to look at getting a job as being the end of the road. But it ought to be, you know, just the start of a journey, really. You know, for the rest of us, we expect to progress in our work life. We don't expect that to come to an end once we've got the wage packet. So, you know, it's building that into it as well. I think that's a really important part of it.
That's really helpful. Thank you. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener. And good morning, panel. Thanks for all your answers so far. Tracy, you touched on employers and how sometimes they're afraid to take on young people. You know, there's issues with how they feel, and they don't want to do a bad job. They don't want to get it wrong. What support do you think we could put in place, or how can we help with that?
Well, actually, I think the example that I just gave of the father going in to talk to the team, yeah, that's actually a really good one. I think listening to people who know the person know their skills, know them really very well, and can share that. That would be really helpful for employers. I think connecting employers with other employers who are also wanting to make progress in this area. And I know that SUES, the Scottish Union of Supported Employment, and there's other agencies as well that bring employers together and help them to share good practice and realise that actually that they're not alone with this. I think connecting employers together can be a really helpful thing too. What else might help? Anne-Marie, were you going to come in there?
Is it okay to speak?
Yeah, I'm sure. Mm-hmm.
I used to be a job finder in a previous life and worked with employers, and what worked really well was in the employer having a point of contact. So if there was any matter that needed to be resolved, they knew who to pick up the phone to within the service that supported. And it could be minor, it could be... I supported a young gentleman with Down syndrome in a cutlery factory once, and his job role was changing. So the employer did not want to... dismiss the young gentleman, there was a retraining needed. So having somebody to come back in and work with the employer and work with the young gentleman to make sure that he was retrained and kept a job. So a point of contact in the service is critical. So you can just iron out problems as they arise, and they could be minor or major. So it's a point of contact with the service. Getting employers engaged is really critical. You know, I've put down in my notes, modern recruitment practices kind of have pushed people with learning disabilities further from the labour market, because mm-hmm. most recruitment practices now are done online, and there's an assumption that people with learning disabilities have the digital capability to apply online. And the Scottish Union of Supported Employment have a great toolkit for employers to ensure that the digital recruitment practices are fair and equitable. But what really works well with employers is having that initial dialogue with them about, employing somebody with a learning disability or somebody who has autism that will not impact on your output negatively. It will impact positively to your employees and your output. So that's dialogue. That's a job finder going in, speaking to the employer, speaking to the employees, in some cases the parent going in beforehand, and just being reassured that the support is there for the young person and for the employees and the workforce. In the letter that was sent to Mr. Neil Gray, I don't know if he's here today, but it did say that employers find it easier to make adaptations to support someone with a physical disability, but it can be more complicated for somebody with learning disabilities. And I think having a key contact person, either in a service or a parent, is key to the success of the person with the learning disability going in there.
Thanks, Anne-Marie. And generally, what more can employers do to make recruitment processes and workplaces more inclusive? What more do you think employers should be doing?
Do you want to come in? Well, our young people have kind of expressed sort of concern about when they go for jobs, they don't, it's on issues around format, perhaps getting questions in advance so they can prepare for interviews. And then equally afterwards, if they're unsuccessful, to get feedback why and understand that. And that can be where policy has been maybe slightly unhelpful. The disability confidence scheme doesn't get a particularly good press, and certainly the issues with it is that even with the highest level of accreditation with disability confident, the evidence has shown that a year on there's no requirement for employers to actually made any changes and actually employed a disabled person. So for a disabled person, for example, seeing that an employer has disability confident, that could actually not end up being that helpful because their practice hasn't changed in a kind of positive and meaningful way. And things like the provision that you should interview everyone who has the minimum requirements if they have a disability. Again, that's not always that helpful, because if they're getting an interview but they were never really going to get the job in is a really unhelpful outcome. And that's the kind of frustration we've had from the young people we've spoken to. It's like, you psych yourself up for jobs, you go through the process, and then it's another brick wall because you know that the employer isn't interested really in employing someone particularly when we're looking at kind of issues around autism and neurodiversity in particular. Thank you.
I think there's it starts with the way that jobs are described and advertised, to be honest. And I think a lot of employers, when they're advertising a job, they will overcomplicate it. They will put a lot of language in there that doesn't really relate necessarily to the job, the role that they're trying to fill. And I can see why they do that, because obviously they're wanting to broaden it out and bring in the best candidates for the job and so on. But if you as a young disabled person are looking at that and going, well, you know, I have never led a team, I've never excelled in whatever it happens to be, therefore I can't apply for this job. And maybe you're actually, you know, you could be very eligible at it, you could have the skills that they need, but you don't see yourself reflected in the description. I think that can sometimes be quite off-putting. And I think one thing I would say to employers, especially for entry-level jobs, which is the young people we're talking about, you know, be very specific about what it is you're looking for and what you can provide as well. Can you provide help to develop skills? Because again, if you're looking at something and thinking, well, they need all of these skills and I don't have them, therefore there is no point in going for them. And in actual fact, you know, the employer may not need all of that. They may just need something a little bit more kind of fine-tuned. And I think, you know, that brings me on to a point about the language that we use as well. And I think a lot of young people, their experience coming through school is, we've talked about aspirations and the fact that, you know, they're told, well, this is not for you, or they grow up thinking this is not for you. So many of the discussions that you have around getting support and so on, it's deficit-led language. It's about what you can't do. It's about focusing on, you know, where your challenges are and so on. So when young people are moving into the area of, you know, sort of applying for jobs where they have to sell themselves to an extent, you know, that they don't have that experience. Everyone's been telling them for so long that they can't do stuff. And now they're having to say, well, what can I do? And I think that's a shift that it's almost like we're creating a barrier by using that language and putting them in that situation that doesn't serve them well when it comes to trying to get into the workplace. So I think there's something there about the job descriptions and, you know, that kind of thing. And then the interviews, you know, how you interview people, having a little bit of flexibility. Is it possible to interview someone? Some people will want to send in a video for an interview. Some people will be happy filling in, you know, sort of forms or answering structured questions. But again, it's listening to people about what they say they need. And if someone is asking for an adjustment, rather than saying, well, we can't do that because, why not just look at it and say, well, okay, is there a way we can make this work for you? Because very often, if you have that mentality, there is. Not always, but, you know, very often that there is. So there are things around, you know, how employers could make that progress a little more straightforward, a little easier for young people particularly, who don't have the experience behind them to go, well, you know, I can fake it till I make it. I can do this. You know, they need to know that it's something that they can do before they're going to go into it.
Okay. One final question. Hopefully this will be quite quick. From everything I've heard from young people that have come in to speak to us and what I've heard round the table, particularly today, is that school is the start of a good journey. You know, we have spoken about what happens at school. We heard some young people saying they had amazing experiences and some had very bad experiences. But is that where we really need to think about getting it right before the rest of their sort of life journey continues?
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. I think starting early has to be, the conversations and the support has to start early.
Because the other thing that I've picked up is that, you know, if you get parents involved and you think about aspirations, you know, because we heard from young people that, you know, they really didn't feel that they should even be thinking in that way, to have that sort of life journey and to work. So school's the key to the whole good journey.
Working in partnership with agencies that can support the young person transition out.
Yeah.
I wouldn't put the whole responsibility onto the schools.
No, yeah. But that's that's where it
probably
should be.
As well, would say peer support as well, which is critical. You know, there's some great work by, you know, Glasgow Disability Alliance, you know, disabled people's organisations working in partnership, and if those partnerships could be improved with schools and having, you know, different communities working together, I think that would be really positive. And, you know, disabled people need to, like everyone, we need to see ourselves in roles and in different life experiences. So having that peer support, I think, is critical.
Okay, thank you very much.
I was lucky enough to spend a month in Finland in the autumn, and one of the looking at transitions and how transitions are managed there. And one of the programmes that I came across within schools is, it's the TUVA programme, and I can't possibly tell you what that is in Finnish. It wouldn't work. But for young people, it's towards the end of school. It's when they finish their, you know, their compulsory component of school, so from the age of 16. And it's particularly for young people who've got additional support needs but need a little bit of time out to think about what they're going to do next. And they can apply for the TUVA programme, and they have up to 38 weeks, during which there's no pressure on them to go for qualifications or anything else. It's entirely focused on, you know, sort of helping them identify what needs they still have to fill. So for some young people, it might be literacy and numeracy. It might be an academic thing. For other young people, it might be skills development. But it gives them that space and that time to work with guidance coaches to be able to, you know, just bring themselves to the point of going, right, now I know what I want to do next, and this is how I'm going to get there. And for some of them, it's around work experience, trying things out, seeing how that works. And I know that, you know, it really impressed me that it was just allowing young people at that critical time in their lives to take a breathing space and think about who do I want to be, because they maybe haven't had the chance to do that. And I know that's something that isn't within our system at the moment. But there is something there about, you know, making it person-centred, making it centred on the young person, giving them that time and being individual. So, you know, I just share that. And the other thing I was going to add was how important it is that chance of trying things out. And I think a lot of young people are not getting the opportunity to do work experience or work placements before they're being asked to make decisions about what jobs they might apply for. And there's things like the ILF Transitions Fund that can be used to help people try things out. There's volunteering, there's, you know, internships and so on, that actually just help people to work out, is this for me or is it not? Because you can't, especially, and again, thinking about young autistic people, but, you know, it's very difficult to picture yourself in something if you haven't actually physically seen it and been there. If you get the chance to do that, even if it's just for a couple of days, it can make a big difference in helping you, you know, sort of shape what you think you might do.
Thank you. Brian Whittle, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'm just going to maybe follow on from my colleague there around some of her questioning there. One of the things that I've kind of followed through this inquiry is around employers being informed of the support that's required. So we're talking here about how do we get young people into employment, but looking at it from the other end, how are we making sure that our employers are well informed of the support that's there for them to be able to accept, you know, disability into the workforce? I'll come to you first, Tracy, if I could.
I think it comes down to communication, doesn't it? And I think, you know, we know that there are pockets of good practice. We know that there's information out there. But it takes such a long time to track it down. And if we were able to bring some of that into, you know, like a central hub, I mean, I don't want to give another task to Skills Development Scotland, but maybe an agency like that might be a good agency to do that, or SEWS possibly. But if there was one place we could bring the information around that so that people can access it and know where to go, and not be, you know, sort of searching around for lots of different bits of information in different places, I think that would be helpful.
I think what we've heard is there is this sort of underlying willingness and desire for employers to have a broad workforce, but there is a fear and there is this lack of knowledge. And just say, I understand what you're saying. You know, but we should maybe the messaging has to be consistent across the country.
I think it has to be consistent. I think there's also And this again links to a piece of work that we're developing within ARC at the moment, as are other agencies too. It's lived experience training. It's actually, you know, bringing people into the workforce or into the workplace, you know, who are autistic or, you know, whatever condition they happen to have, and leading training or being heavily involved in the training for the workforce. And this is something that, as I say, I know other organisations are doing too. We're starting to develop it in ARC. And I think that's one of the ways of breaking down the barriers, because very often, if you don't know somebody with a disability, there isn't somebody in your family or whatever, then there is that kind of, I'm not quite sure how to talk to them, I'm not quite sure, you know, what can I do, what can I can't do. Once you've met somebody and got to know them as a person, forget the condition, you've got to know them as a person, then that barrier just melts away. So the more that we can bring people together through things like lived experience training and so on, I think that's the part of the process of building up that confidence.
Anne-Marie, you used the words early intervention, my favourite two words I use in this place, everybody groaning around the table. For me, I wanted to understand. You know, do we have a sufficient understanding of the journey of those who are experiencing that sort of transition into adulthood with the added factor of disability? Do we understand that well enough? And you also talked about in early intervention the outcomes in terms of long term outcomes. Has there been any work been done around, you know, that it almost, if we're going to, we need more resource, but if we focus that resource on early intervention, the impact that has on the requirement of resource further down the line?
So early intervention is one thing, but it's also the number of people with learning disabilities in the country just now who are adults and they don't have place or space, they don't have employment, they don't have perhaps a social worker because the transition out of wherever they were going. If we go into early intervention, the resource is, I just think it's aligning, I'm repeating myself, so I do apologise, services that are aligning themselves to each other, you know, health, social work, secondary education, colleges and employment services. And if we get all of that right, and the employment service, be it ARC or be it SDS or the Department of Work and Pensions, which it could be, the support is there throughout the young person's life. Early intervention is key, so somebody's not lost through the system. You know, you're not lost when you transition into college and transition out. There's nothing there. Your social worker's left, and you have a waiting list for a few months till we get that on track. Early intervention is really important, absolutely. And I've worked in a college where the social work aligned itself, the health aligned itself, and it was a good multidisciplinary approach, but it's not consistent across Scotland. But if we could come up with a model that I'm always cautious because of my experience of working with people with learning disabilities and people with autism, if you come up with a model, you're expecting for people to fit into that model, it mightn't work. But if it's a framework to work within and not setting tablets of stone, I think that would work well.
I suppose what we're really getting at is I completely understand where you're coming from in terms of those who are later on in their journey. So early intervention is not an option for them. But if we, while in supporting these people here, if we get into early intervention right, we have less of those people as we go through. As we go through time, they will, you know, I think that's where I'm really getting to in terms of the need to do early intervention, resourcing early intervention more than we currently do.
Yeah, and it comes back to what your colleague, Mr. Beattie, said. You know, if let's say that 48%, and we start early intervention there in secondary school, it's the tracking and monitoring thereafter, so people aren't, you know, it's not just giving the early intervention, it's making sure that the outcomes are positive for the individuals. And dare I say, it's not always paid employment, it could be therapeutic employment, it could be volunteering, but it's a package, it's a service for the young person throughout their life. But early intervention my experience is key. It's just, it's so key for the success, for the family, for the, but most importantly for the young person.
And you've led me very nicely into the question I was going to ask you, Charlotte, around data gaps. Do we have enough data in terms of following the pathway and the journey of these young people into you know, positive destinations and how they have how they cope? Do we have enough data and information there to be able to be more informed in terms of the resource and where we need to deploy that resource?
No, I don't think currently we do. I think Tracy is probably the person to speak to through the Compass innovation and the data collection there. I don't know if you want to... sorry to pass over.
Yes, I can do that. I would say I don't think we do. Mm-hmm. Around this particular group of young people, we have developed a resource. It's a digital tool that was launched a year ago. Called Compass, and it's intended to collect feedback from professionals, from young people, and from parents and carers right the way through that journey up to 25. So it's looking at things around support and so on, but it's also looking at, you know, how that positive outcome, that movement, that journey is going. So it might be going quite successfully at one point, and then maybe 6 months, a year later, maybe it's not happening. Perhaps something has dried up. You know, the job hasn't worked out, the college place hasn't worked out. So up until now, we've had nothing beyond that point of finishing school and saying where someone's moved on to. That's been the only bit of data that's been routinely collected. What we're hoping with Compass is that people will now start using that over a period of time, and we can track and see how things are going. We can see where the difficulties are, where more of the support is needed, and we'll also be able to evaluate how making some of those adjustments is changing. Now, obviously, it's early days for this. It's only been out there for a year. We've got 1,000 users so far. So we're starting to be able to collect robust data on that. But over the next 2, 3, 4 years, then hopefully we'll be able to be starting to build up a body of evidence that will actually answer exactly that question. What's happening? How is it happening? And when we make this change, does that make a difference? So we're not there yet, but we're on the way.
Okay.
Can I just say something about, just from the employer's perspective, it raises questions whether there could be a system of mandatory reporting from employers or larger employers about the numbers of disabled employees that they have in the workforce, and whether you change the culture from the employer perspective, and again getting that information about the disabled workforce.
Okay.
Thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Murdo Fraser.
Okay, thanks very much, convener, and good morning, panel. We've spoken a lot about the lack of coordination between services, and you've very helpfully given us some pointers on how it can be improved. We touched upon the fact that the Scottish Government is developing its first national transition to adulthood strategy, and it's got a focus on 5 priority areas. And I just want to ask whether the 5 priority areas are the correct priority areas to be focused on. They include empowerment for the young person, clear and coherent information, coordination of individual support, consistency of practice and support, and data to measure progress. Are those the right priorities for the strategy, or would there be anything you'd want to change within that? Tracy, probably first.
I think they're good priorities. I think, you could have a list of 10, 20, but that's impractical. You know, for a strategy, you've got to narrow it down. And as I said, we've been part of the group that's been discussing and engaging with the government team around this. I'm conducting consultations with parents at the moment on these 5 priorities, and which ones, do they think they're the right priorities? Right. Which ones do they think are most important? And one of the questions I ask as part of that consultation is there anything missing? And so far, nobody has come back saying anything has been missing. So I think one of the things I'm doing is asking, of these 5 priorities, which 3 would make the biggest difference, the biggest practical difference in your lives? Mm-hmm. And people are having no problem with that question. They're actually seeing themselves reflected in that. So I think it's a pretty good framework, yes.
Anders want to comment on that?
I mean, I think it's really useful in, I can't argue with the five principles. I think what is useful in terms of a transitions policy is having this framework. Scotland's unusual in having this approach. If you look at other OECD countries, there isn't a kind of unified transitions policy. So I think it's definitely in the right direction, and I would certainly welcome that kind of approach.
Anne-Marie, anything to add?
No, no. I sit on that group as well. I think it's a positive group, and what I like about it is the individual voice is paramount here.
So, Charlotte, you talked about the unusual way that Scotland's approaching this. Mm. And my question was going to be, is there anywhere, I mean, I know you, Tracy, talked about Finland, but is there anywhere that we can learn lessons from? That are doing this transition work better than we are?
I don't see a kind of good practice model. I see kind of flags of concern. In Australia, they put quite a lot of money into disability employment for disabled people, but their outcomes are no better. And when you kind of you look at the research and dig a bit deeper, a lot of that links into the lack of early intervention and not doing the legwork earlier on. So, you know, they've had a policy that's had the resource, but it hasn't had the outcome. So that's where I would kind of raise the concerns when we're looking in this area. But there isn't a country which I would say, oh, that's doing really well.
Tracy?
I was interested. When I went to Finland, one of the reasons for going was because I thought that I would be able to identify things. And there were a few things, like the TUVA programme I've spoken about. But I was really struck by how much interest there was in Finland in the principles of good transitions, which I mentioned earlier that ARC produced, which is like the benchmark for good practice in Scotland, and the work we'd done in the Principles into Practice programme and what we'd learned from that. And the number of people who were saying, oh, we don't have anything like this. Why don't we? You know, we should be developing this. And, you know, one of the things I'm hoping to do is maybe work with some of the people I connected up with just to share a little bit more about what we have. So I think at the policy level, you know, we're doing really, really well. It's always that implementation gap, isn't it? But at policy level, I mean, you would never say there's nothing we can learn. Of course, there's always we can always improve. But we have the frameworks, we have the structures, it's there. We just need to think a little bit more about how we can make it happen. Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Murdo Fraser, to be followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Can I ask about the issue of consistency of approach across Scotland and whether we're seeing a postcode lottery or whether we're seeing some degree of consistency? And specifically, if there isn't consistency, what more do you think the Scottish Government could do to try and promote best practice? Charlotte, you're smiling. Do you want to start?
No, I think there is a postcode lottery that comes up continually. And it goes back to, I mean, obviously Scotland's a diverse geography and there's different issues about services and supports in different areas. And I think this is where the kind of principles approach does come in usefully, because there will be a marker for what should underpin transitions policy. I mean, obviously local authorities are in a good position, or should be in a good position, to reflect the needs of local communities, but there is a disparity certainly across the country.
Tracy?
I think that there are good programs, as we know. They tend to be short term, so funding is pulled quite quickly, and they're not really given time to embed. And when you start something like this, it tends not to be considered how you could scale that up if it's successful. How you can make that universal. So I think it's a challenge for organisations when you don't know if you're going to be funded beyond 2 years. For example, 2 years is not long enough to make a difference with anything. There's a little bit of vulnerability, I think, in there. And if you're, for example, if you're in areas like the Borders, or if you're in areas like Highland, which are very geographically dispersed, it's really quite difficult to get make consistency of access across areas like that. So there does need to be some thought, I think, in, you know, how we identify areas of good practice and how we scale that up, and then how we overcome some perhaps of the geographical barriers that might be in place that stop people accessing some of the services that, you know, they might otherwise benefit from. So, you know, it's I think those are the key factors for me, I would say.
Yeah, sure. Just before I bring in Anne-Marie, Tracy, can I ask you specifically about the principles into practice trials?
Yes.
So I understand these are being implemented across 10 local authorities at the moment. Can you say a bit more about that and what the experience of that has been so
yes,
far?
Yes, sure. Well, we published the 7 principles of good transitions quite some time ago, but what we were hearing was, you know, this is all very well, but how do we make that you know, happen in practice? Yep. So the trials took place from 2020 to 2022, and there were 10 local authority areas involved. You can tell from the dates, COVID was a bit of an impact. It didn't go, we weren't able to do it in quite the way that we'd originally planned, but I think it was testament to the authorities' enthusiasm for this and their commitment to it that they stayed involved for the whole of those 2 years. Nobody said, I'm sorry, this is something we can't manage at the moment. So a lot of the what we asked the local authority areas to do was to identify something, you know, particularly kind of focused around transitions, and focus on making some changes around that and then evaluating how much of a difference it actually made. Mm-hmm. And we gave them support and help with that. We gave them evaluation questions. We connected them together in a network, which is still going on, a learning exchange network, to bring them together. And there's all the reports from it are online. You know, I can share the link with the committee later if you would be interested in that. We did put out a report of findings. Every local authority area did come up with something slightly different because they were working with a different cohort of people. But when you put that together, it's basically produced, you know, something that we can guarantee works. Mm. If this framework that's structured around the 7 principles of good transitions, it's an improvement framework, you can monitor your progress, and then, you know, you can sort of look for the next stages and how else you want to progress. So it's very practical. It's backed up by evidence from, you know, real situations. And it's something that now we're out rolling out across other local authority areas as well. But the key for involvement was that you know, there needs to be a commitment from the local authority that they want to make a difference in this area, and they're prepared to make some time available to it, some resource available to it, to be able to sustain that and support the staff who are doing it. But if they're prepared to do that, then we're working with them. I think we're now up to, off the top of my head, I think it's 13 local authorities. We've had 3 more who've said, yes, you know, we like the look of this, we would like to be part of it. So, you know, we're hoping that this is something that over time, again, is going to transform some of their practice.
Okay, interesting. Was there any local authority that stood out as being an exemplar?
That would be a very unfair question to ask, isn't it? Lots of them in different ways.
Okay.
I think the one that I would signal, I referred to it earlier, it was the local authority that trialled the transition coordinator and that role, you know, sort of going across adults, yeah. Children and adult services. And I will name names there. That was Falkirk Council who tried that. Okay. And that was something that I do know now of several other local authority areas who are speaking to them to try and see how, you know, how that can translate into their practice as well.
All right, thank you, that's very helpful. Anne-Marie, do you want to add anything?
I would like to go back to your question, if you don't mind. You didn't ask me about good... and I had a good answer. Is that okay?
Yes,
and then
of course,
I could answer your... Yeah. I was awfully hurt. I'm okay. So I'm going to say Ireland. Now, it's not just because I've got an Irish accent and I'm sitting here today from Ireland, but Ireland have very good examples of supported employment opportunities for people with learning disabilities and for people with autism. And it's not just looking at the employment aspect, but it's looking at tenancy, it's looking at an individual's social needs, it's looking at an individual's, dare I say, spiritual needs, and it's looking at their even transitioning into adulthood transition and into retirement, you know, so the whole transition process from early intervention, like what you had mentioned, but given a service throughout an individual's journey in life, that's supported the whole way through. And I know I work there, I haven't seen anything like it in Scotland. It was quite transformational. You know, I started my career where I worked in a sheltered workshop, and we were like, we're going to change this service, and it's going to be person-centred, and we're going to look at employment, and we're going to support that. So the answer is, Ireland have quite a good process and transitions from school to social to employment to tenancies. Yes, okay. I'll take that action.
And my apologies for not for missing you.
I'm over it. I'm over it. I don't hold
I can hear you're over it.
Yeah. I was silent, crying silently. In
I'll bring in Kevin Shearer.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, and I'll try not to miss anyone out. We've heard a lot from young folk, not only the folk from the usual place that we had in the other week, but you know, even last night I had a conversation with someone around about what their autistic daughter wants and what she needs. The kids themselves, the young folk themselves, had very strong opinions about certain things. They were all very articulate. I'm going to be harsh, I'm afraid, Anne-Marie, because the young folk for the usual place thought college was a tick box exercise and that nobody listened to them. They had strong views about schooling as well and what worked and what didn't. Some views about parents and parents impeding them from reaching their full potential and aspiring to what they wanted to do. My question basically is, do we listen to the voices of lived experience enough when it comes to the shaping of policy and services? And if we could start with Tracy, that would be grand.
I think it's getting better. You know, it's more, it feels to me like it's more routine now to be actively seeking the voices of lived experience, and that's a huge step forward. Yeah, I've actually just written down on my sheet here, people, not process. I think, you know, we get very hung up sometimes on the process, understandably, but, you know, remembering that it's people at the centre, and it's people's lives that we're talking about. And going back to what we were saying about why is transition so important, what makes this... It's because it sets the trajectory for the rest of someone's adult life. And this is, you know, it's their family situation, it's whether they're in poverty or not, it's, you know, all of that. These have very real world, you know, people, individual impacts. And I think we, you know, the voice of lived experience is what reminds us of that. If you've got somebody in the room, you're not talking about a caseload, you're talking about that person. And that's really, really important. So I think we do it more. I think we could still do it more than we do. Yeah.
Charlotte, please.
Yeah, I think, as Tracy said, it has improved. I mean, I think we're having different conversations around lived experience than we would have done 10 years ago. I feel very much with the responsibility in academia as well, that when, you know, it's not our research, it's very much led by the young people. We've tried to bring in different voices. We've used creative methodologies. So the young people expressing their viewpoints around transitions in different ways. But there is, you know, there's a concern that you go and you hear the stories and we talk about it in different settings and then nothing happens. And I think that's the real risk. You know, policy has talked a lot about co-production in recent years. And I think there's really good examples of co-produced policy. But again, you have to implement it and it has to be meaningful. So that's the challenge for policymakers and researchers alike, I think.
Anne-Marie, please.
Yeah, it's very disappointing when you hear that, you know, somebody's had a bad experience in college, because you do your best in colleges to try and support a young person. We try to, at the application stage, invite people to highlight their additional needs so we can, you know, invite the young person in to have a chat. The early intervention, I'm sorry, I keep looking at you when I say early intervention, is so key for the success, because when we get all the information, we can put the support in place. It comes back to the transition process. We're doing things, you know, we're the whole kind of induction into college or university is a very scary process. So we're into implementing quiet inductions over the summer. The student voice is so key to shape the curriculum, but to shape the support around the curriculum. And we're constantly looking at ways to adapt and change that to ensure that we get the voice of people with learning disabilities, and in particular people with autism. But I'll take that one in the chin. It would be so good if people could give us that feedback so we can learn from it, because you want to make college or university a positive experience. The transition in is good, the transition out is good, but also the learning in between is really good, and we've met their pastoral needs, and then sometimes what was the support that you needed. So yeah, it's disappointing to hear that, but it's something we thrive, there's the Irish in me, thrive to improve on an ongoing basis.
The young folk also had positive things to say about certain aspects of their journey. Project Search got a major tick from, I think, almost everyone that I've heard from. Not only just during the course of this inquiry, but also from my own experiences in Aberdeen. Young folk, in some of that aspect of their journey, definitely felt listened to. What do we need to do to change cultures? Because a lot of this is about other people as well. What do we do to change the culture to ensure that young folk with autism, with learning disabilities, are listened to more, are taken seriously, and that, you know, the points that they make are followed up on? We'll start with you this time, Anne-Marie.
There's so much we need to do. I mean, from a college perspective, we have student reps. We need to encourage more student reps who have autism, who have learning disabilities, to be student reps, to be, you know, to get the voice of the students. The Project Search is a really good example of, I'll go back to saying, a multi-agency approach in addressing the employment needs of people with autism and people with learning disabilities. The voice of individuals with learning disabilities is really important. But the language, what Tracy had said, has to be decluttered. It has to be in a way that enables people to make an informed decision. In a previous life, I was an advocate for people with learning disabilities, and it's really important for their voices to be heard, that the language that you use, I don't mean to be condescending, is almost simplified and informed, and you know, even written language, verbal language that we use is simplified and made in a way to enable people to make informed decisions about their future.
So let me go to a specific that you talked about earlier, Anne-Marie. You talked about when you were working in the college sector, that, you know, there was that multidisciplinary team set up with transitions officer and all of the rest of it. That setup, which, you know, is probably wasn't the norm at that time, maybe becoming more so now. Did that set up itself and the people involved in that change the culture overall in other parts of the organisations that folk worked for?
I would have to say yes, because when you go to the meeting, the transition meeting, everybody there was to listen to the young person and their voice and their choices and their preferences. Sometimes it's managing expectations. Mm-hmm. you mentioned earlier, managing expectations from parents and managing expectations from the young person. And that sometimes can be difficult to navigate in terms of what the parents' wishes are and what the young person's wishes are. But all the time we're there to remind ourselves that it was the young person who was transitioning. Where the culture did change was in terms of preferences to the next steps. But again, you're kind of restricted if the services aren't there at the transitions out.
Okay. Does anybody else want to pick up on that cultural aspect? No.
I was just going to say, Tracy, for me, I think the only thing I would add there is positive role models. You know, making people visible. And I think that's people sharing their experiences, but also just, you know, I think that's one of the biggest things, because if you're not sure about aspirations and so on, but you can look at somebody who looks like you and say, okay, yes, they are doing that. If they can do that, so can I. I think that's huge.
Grand, thank you. I have to say that from my perspective, the folks that we've talked to have been very realistic. Some of them pretty ambitious, and that's not a bad thing. And the role model aspect of all of this, one of the young folk that we talked to wants to be an actor, which I think a lot of folk have probably tried to stymie that. But the positive role models now of seeing learning disabled folks, including I think an Irish actor who was recently nominated for an Oscar, at least the film that he was in, has made that difference. So that positive role models need to be brought to the fore as well, you're saying?
I think so, definitely. And actually, that's a really interesting one, because there's a young man who works with me, we do training together, and he wanted to be an actor. And at the time that he said he wanted to be an actor, his voice, he was very difficult for anyone outside the family to understand what he was actually saying. And I know that the family won't mind me sharing this. You know, and his father was the person who said, no, come on, that's not going to work. So he tried other things, didn't actually work out. He did, in the end, with a lot of support, the right support around him, he completed a mainstream drama course and he passed the course. He hasn't gone on to become an actor, but he's now working with me doing training. So he's doing, you know, sort of speaking to groups, and he's using all of those skills, and he's loving the work that he's doing. He's getting paid for doing it. And, you know, if I think his father would, again, wouldn't mind me saying, what they should have done is listen to what he wanted to do in the first place and gone, right, how can we make that work, rather than saying, no, that's not going to work, try this instead. You know, so that's very much a really good role model. And he's self-employed. He's earning, as I say. He's doing
really
well.
Thank you very much indeed. And that positive note, that's me finished, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe just ask one final question. Tracy, you mentioned the pandemic, that it was the principles into practice trials were during the pandemic. And sometimes we kind of forget that we've had a pandemic, but we know it had a big educational impact on some young people. I'd imagine it would include people with additional support needs. So I don't know if anyone wants to comment on how well we're doing, or what the impact was for that cohort of young people, and what we're doing to address the kind of lingering or the long tail of COVID for those young people. I don't know, Anne-Marie, if you want to come in first, if you have any comment on that.
It was significantly difficult for people with learning disabilities during the pandemic. At that time, I'm only speaking at my experience, I managed a faculty where we had a significant number of people with learning disabilities on colleges courses, and it, speaking to parents, it was so difficult, because quite a lot of other students on other courses could go onto the digital platforms and go online and learn their course. For people with learning disabilities, that wasn't as easy as their peers. And when we were kind of targeting students to come back on campus, because if you remember, it was August 20 when we were kind of getting people back onto campus, the priority group for the area that I managed was people with learning disabilities, because they were quite isolated. Some people were in tenancies. There was no way to do your course. Some people had the digital capability, some people didn't. We had to work a lot with parents, with transport. I have never worked as hard as that August 2020 reopening our campus, just to make it right, to make it safe, to implement new ways of teaching, to ensure people were getting good teaching and good transition, and we were engaging, you know, even, you know, at that time we would have had three individuals sharing a taxi that went to one per taxi. It was quite profound. I had a lot of parents on the phone saying, please, just, my son is so lonely. They're, you know, college is not only about the learning, it was also about their peers, their friendship, the social aspect to it. And then I think, if my memory serves me right, we kind of went back into almost a second phase at Christmas, so January 21, and then getting kind of materials out for students to ensure that they had enough to do during the second phase and met their curriculum needs. Quite a lot of the curriculum that we run was practical. You know, there was work placements associated, there was cooking, there was arts and craft. It was quite difficult.
Do you think those young people need additional support? That's a group for those 2 years that haven't been able to even access what we do offer.
Yeah.
And do you think that's been provided to them? Do you think it's recognised that that's a big group of young people that need...
Yes, and we did elongate their time in college, but it was extremely difficult time for people with learning disabilities and people with autism. And sorry for looking at you, you know, I just don't want to leave out. But it was extremely difficult. But I know as a college that I worked in, you know, there was people like our engineering students had to get back on campus. Our construction students had to get back on campus, but what was agreed unilaterally that our students with learning disabilities had to get back on campus and continue with their learning. And our staff were amazing, and our support staff, our lecturing staff, they were amazing, and it was a lot of work. You're going back to a time when it was 2 metre social distancing. You know, we went around with a 2 metre stick making sure all the... there was a lot of work with the staff. The management of the college, the executive of the college worked, not only the college I worked in, a lot of colleges.
Before I see if Charlotte and Tracy want to ask, I think, Brian, did you want a supplementary? Did you want to come in on this before?
It's not a supplementary to your question, but it's a different question, so if you want to finish.
If Tracy or Charlotte would like to comment on the impact of the pandemic and what that means for the group of young people that were caught in that situation in terms of their transitions.
From both the young people and parents speaking, I think the impact was absolutely profound, particularly in terms of social care. Services which obviously stopped because of the pandemic during lockdown haven't been fully reinstated. There's real gaps there. And also in terms of mental health, speaking to ILF Transitions, which is, as you know, is quite an innovatory policy in giving sums of money to disabled people, to young disabled people, to try something new is the kind of strap line. They've kind of had a much greater demand on mental health related services. There's profound mental health impact from the pandemic, so that's really, you know, something that I'm very aware of.
Yeah, I think we're very much still in the fallout from that for young people, you know, all young people, but particularly thinking about the disabled young people. And we do, you're right, we do tend to forget so quickly. It's kind of like we've almost gone back to normal. And I think the only thing I would add is that, you know, one thing that I've heard from some young disabled people is, well, during the pandemic, everything went online. You know, we could work online then, we could get our learning online, we could do this. Why can't we do it now? You know, the technology is there, we've shown it can be done. Why can we not make these adjustments for us? Because it happened when it was important for everybody else. You know, why can't it happen now?
If it's a brief supplementary, I'll let you in, Mr. Whittle, as the panel have been here longer than they anticipated.
Okay. No, it's almost like a sum up of what's been said, you know, in terms of, you know, the journey that we need to go on. As I think we all now, the amount of evidence we've taken, we understand an awful lot more of the journey of young people. You talked to Anne-Marie about you need to, you know, individual approach, and I think that's in general to any person, let alone somebody with special support needs. And then we hear, you know, we're now at a stage where half the people in schools are needing special support needs. I speak at this as a father of a daughter who's head of guidance at a school. They're under extraordinary pressure already, and then we're coming up with these, you know, extra resources and extra support that's going to be needed. So I suppose the question, if you look at it in its entirety, it looks massive, the changes that we need to make, but we need to start somewhere. So what would be your asks in the first instance to start us along this process of closing that gap? Easy question. Go on, Charlotte.
I'd suppose early intervention, start early. That would be start having the conversations and the discussions and the inclusion around transitions early.
Okay.
Transition officers in schools, colleges, universities.
And I would add information, focus on information, making information accessible and easy to find.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your evidence this morning. That's been much appreciated and will help us with inquiry. That now concludes the evidence session, and we'll move into private session. Thank you.